holding the line
for the conservative movement.
This is Stacy on the Right on SiriusXM Patriot 125.
Welcome, friends. Thank you so much for your time and your ears. So grateful to have you here this evening. Moving into the program, you can find out more at stacyontheright.com. If you'd like to see the show notes, find out about our guests. I'm so happy to welcome in tonight Jack Brewer, former NFL great. He's a founder of the Jack Brewer Foundation. He's a presidential appointee. So many other great things that he's doing for us in this country. Jack, thank you for your time tonight.
Great to be back with you, sister.
I'm so glad you're here. I have so much to talk to you about. I want to start off. I know Martin Luther King Day is Monday, and you have an upcoming op-ed, and it's about a subject that you spend, really, you're devoting your life to this, and that is fatherlessness, children who don't have fathers and need someone to step in and fill that role for them. The title of your upcoming piece over at Fox News is Fatherlessness, the Modern Civil Rights Crisis, Echoing Martin Luther King Jr.'s Legacy. Talk to us about what you're saying here.
Well, Stacey, you know, Dr. King marched for jobs and freedom. And in that time, you know, people based on the color of their skin and the zip code that they lived in faced oppression. And today, you know, I would say that our civil rights crisis is even deeper when it comes to the spiritual warfare that our children and our families are facing today. And we have a crisis that, like we've never seen, like the world's never seen. I mean, we are the most fatherless nation on the planet. I mean, we have 18.4 million fatherless kids. And when you look at the numbers, I mean, they're staggering. I mean, you start to look at the fact that the majority of men in prison, the vast majority of men in prison, grew up without dads in the home. And then you start to look at those men, and they didn't have fathers. And you see this generational curse that's just being passed on generation after generation. And now it's fed into the culture where now it's acceptable for a man not to man up, not to be the head of his household, to have, you know, children and not take care of them. All those things have become the norm in America. And it just wasn't that way even a few decades ago. And so, you know, the civil rights issue of our time today is without a doubt fatherlessness. I mean, people talk about, you know, the abortion issue and life issue. Well, those stem from fatherlessness. Those stem from a culture that has been lied to, that a man has no right in the say on whether even his son or daughter lives. You have no right to demand to stand up for your child and not to be aborted if that's the decision a woman wants to make. And so we've stripped the father of their role in this nation, and I think we're paying a grim, grim price. I think Dr. Martin Luther King and any other civil rights leaders of their time would be devastated if they saw the America that we live in today.
They would be, and they would wonder why we had such a, I mean, it was a stout and very, very effective civil rights movement. It was a civil rights movement that moved throughout this country, and things were accomplished. Lives were changed. So for us to be where we are now, where you have children who just, they just don't get a dad, they are obviously created by two human beings, but one of those human beings is not just absent, but it's a pernicious absence that is supported by the government, that the government actually facilitates.
That's right. I mean, when you look at, you know, just the thought of you incentivizing a man and a woman not to be brought together in marriage, and, you know, tying the welfare in these programs, entitlement programs to people. It really is sick. It's taking advantage of the most underserved. It's taking advantage of the most uneducated in our nation. And it's really, really sad. And you start to see these same communities where you have the highest rates of welfare. You have the highest rates of fatherlessness. You know, unfortunately, you know, it has metastasized in the black community. You know, where we have over 75% of our kids today are born from parents out of wedlock. It's just become a norm in the culture. And you start to see the reading and math proficiency levels in these same communities rival third world countries. You know, we have, you know, places like Baltimore and in Los Angeles, Detroit, and other areas where you literally have entire schools and sometimes school districts with not a single child proficient in math. Some schools have not a single child proficient in reading. And it's become acceptable. I mean, even LeBron James, God bless him for what he tried to do with the school in Akron. But this guy has a school where not a single kid can read and do math on grade level. I mean, it's absolutely embarrassing. You know, we have a lot now. You have a generation of men who were raised by women, and nothing's wrong with that. But you need masculinity. You got to have masculinity. So when all of your leaders don't understand what it means for the man to be the head of the household, you really have a spiritual lapse in society, and I think that's what we're seeing today. We've been, you know, it's allowed, and I say it's allowed because men aren't men now. Men don't stand up for their communities. They don't stand up for their children. Their voices have been weakened, whether it's from you know, these systematic issues that we just discussed, or it's just cultural. Right? But they've been weakened. The voice of the man has been weakened. I mean, even out in the state of California, we're talking about not allowing young boys to even play football, even if their parents want them to. And so, you know, you got this, you know, this matriarch mentality and perspective that's just going through America and really destroying the soul of this nation. You know, we've lost our morality. You know, the father is not standing up for the word of God, allowing these school districts to strip out prayer and to strip out the word of God from schools all around us. And so, you know, we've really created, you know, this dark, dark culture that's godless, and it's showing in our communities. And it's just really a travesty when you start to think of the America that once was compared to the America we live in today.
And so, Jack, when I hear you talking about this, I know you're speaking truth. I've seen the statistics, but I also will encounter people, and I just feel like just getting up and either walking away or banging my head against the wall, because I remember having a very similar conversation where people were I was actually in a place where you get your hair done, and it was nothing but black women in there. And one of the women was complaining about some of the situations that were going on in the neighborhood where this salon is located. And it's actually a neighborhood that's being gentrified, but not in the way you would think, because it's a lot of black owned businesses that are popping up over there and doing really well. And so as the neighborhood changes, you know, you see people having different expectations about how it's going to be when they're there. And the complaints were just flying. And I said, well, you'll find that most of the children who are committing these acts that you're complaining about are coming from fatherless homes. And one lady said, well, they're not really fatherless because their dads are in their lives. They just don't live in their home. And I said, I don't know. I think it's fatherlessness, because if a child doesn't have that influence in their life on a full-time basis, that's fatherlessness. A part-time dad who shows up on birthdays and holidays, or who is a babysitter of his own child, that is not the same as the dad who is there every night at dinner time after work, modeling the everyday work ethic, modeling the anti-crime mental mindset, talking to the child about their ideas, banishing foolishness and nonsense. I would see it at our dinner table all the time. One of my kids would say something, and I wouldn't even think anything of it. And my husband would point out the foolishness of it, because foolishness lies in the heart of a child. And he would just correct it so deftly, not putting the child down, but correcting that wrong mental thought process that kind of, you know, I didn't really even see it as a problem. He would do that seamlessly over dinner, and then, you know, keep it moving. He reinforced the biblical ethos at bedtime with them. There were just many times where I, as their mother, was doing everything that I knew how to do, but there were still moments that only could happen with their dad. And I see people all the time, they really like to downgrade and denigrate the impact of a father, but we know it's real. But there's this automatic backlash. I had no one in that place who would agree with me that children need a full-time dad. They would not agree, but they were complaining about crime and teenagers running around and skipping school, but they couldn't make the connection. Jack, it was just crazy.
It is. It's the spirit. You know, unfortunately, it's Jezebel's spirit. Unfortunately, it's the spirit that has deceived so many females in America to really start to buy in to this unnatural family unit. They've started to buy in to the realities of this culture instead of the realities of the Word of God. And so, you know, whenever you start to see, you know, ungodliness is truth, there's a real issue there. And so I think that's what it is at the core, and it's unfortunate because it really is taking a toll on kids. And then, like you say, I mean, I'm a father, and I have my first kid out of wedlock. And the difference that you can tell in the way that I approach both fathering both my kids, and I was with my kids all the time, but still, it's like you said, being in that home every day, there's nothing like it. And so, you know, fatherhood is an action word. It's not one that you're born into. To be a true father, you have to be there taking that stand. But really, from a spiritual perspective, you have to set the tone. And if you don't set the tone spiritually for your children, then you're not a father. And so that's the thing that's hard for most people to swallow, because in this society, it's acceptable to run from faith. It's acceptable to not want to really, you know, to not want to insult anybody because of their faith. But at the end of the day, you know, Christ said he didn't come here to bring peace but a sword, and that sword is a sword that should be held by the Father, and it's one that should, you know, set the tone and not always say what feels good. And so, you know, I pray that our society can start to move, you know, toward that spirit a little bit more, because what's happening in our streets is just, it's embarrassing, to be quite honest with you, when you know, turn on your TV and you're seeing teenagers shooting each other, you know, and every time you look through the news, you do the count, and it's always a little black boy kills another little black boy, and then you have, you know, these woke-minded individuals, like you just mentioned, who don't want to even admit the truth, right? They don't. They're finding reasons to not address this issue, and it's so serious that now it's at epidemic levels. And you're talking about millions of kids now that are growing up in our nation without a dad. And you go to the prison jails. I'm driving right now from a prison. And in that prison, I got about 92% of my class in that prison. 92% of my class grew up without a dad. And what makes you even more sad is when you start to see how many of those guys' kids have been impacted by the criminal justice system, whether they're arrested or they're in prison now. It's a generational curse. And it, for people not to want to address that, and call it what it is, and to be worrying about feelings and emotions and all how, you know, the words that you use, the terminology. I mean, it's just, you know, it's a result of a generation that's been raised by women, and men that are, you get a bunch of men that are raised by women that have no male influence. Eventually, that culture is going to go rogue, and that's what we're seeing today.
And then just so we're clear here, we know there are mothers out there who are single, who do a good job. We know there are outliers in every one of these situations, but we're talking about the ideal. We're talking about for the bulk of these children. And since the statistic is trending in the wrong direction, it is actually totally appropriate for us to call out what is wrong and to talk about how it can be fixed, to discuss the prescription for it. So there will never be a time when every child is in a two-parent household. But we could achieve levels as we have had before in this culture, where even in the Black community, you had over 88% of all of the children coming from two-parent households. And in white communities, it was over 90%. We now hold the record as a country. We have the highest percentage of children living in single-parent households out of all westernized developed nations. That's our new Like, you know, what are you known for? What's your big calling card? Fatherlessness. That's what we can be famous for here in America right now.
That's right, and that's the reason, Stacy. I'm gonna let you put a little bit of sugar on it so it feels good. I'm gonna come in with the hammer. I'm not backing down from anybody on the left that wants to combat what I'm talking about, and I say that with all love in my heart. But I'm in the prisons every day, and I'm pouring my heart and soul into this issue. And for people to deny the fact of the impact that this issue is having on this nation, and try to live in the lie that it is natural for a young boy not to grow up with a man that is directing him and that is leading him and that is guiding him, and also a nation that wants to live in the lie that women can be the head of a household. I stand against that in the name of Jesus. And I will continue to pour my heart, my soul, my passion into this issue because it means that much to me. And it's that serious. And, you know, sometimes it takes us making people uncomfortable for folks to really want to get behind the true change that needs to happen. And so I'm willing to fall on that sword. I'm willing to take those arrows because, you know, we have to get away from this perspective that it's good for men to be raised like women. I just stand against that.
I'm 100% with you. I make that disclaimer for those who, you know, they had a single mom and they still went to college and they did well. And what they're saying is, you know, sometimes the circumstances are bad. Sometimes the father is killed. But on the main, our goal, our ideal, the thing that we work towards as a culture, and certainly the thing that our taxpayer dollars support should be, it must be, the two-parent model, two-parent households. These are the launch pads for success, the launch pads for wealth. They even call it two-parent privilege, marriage privilege. That's what leftists call it. When you come from a two-parent household and you are doing well in life, they actually try to blame that. Do you hear the language I'm using? They're blaming you and saying that you are a recipient of privilege, and that privilege is your mom and dad married each other for your benefit. So we know it's good if people are literally going to call it privilege. Yes, of course it's what people want. And I refuse to back down on whether or not it's right. We can acknowledge the realities, but it is right and it is proper for children to grow up with their mom and their dad.
No doubt. And Stacey, you know, sometimes when you start looking deeply at these issues and people want to, you know, compare, you know, this situation and that situation, and yes, you can be successful. Of course you can. But the Word of God doesn't tell us to focus on the those that have. It tells us to focus on the least of these. And so I don't base my opinions, my thoughts, and my realities on people that, you know, have means, you know, people that are blessed to be able to, you know, live the American dream. I'm talking about the poorest of the poor. I'm talking about these kids in the street killing each other that are forced to live in these neighborhoods and communities that they would rather not. And I'm talking about these children who are in these broken schools in these inner city neighborhoods where they're reading and math proficiency levels are zero. I'm talking about those individuals, and those individuals are feeling the real impact of this fatherless crisis. And so that's how I respond to that. I don't even think about those that have, because I myself fit in that category, which is why I've dedicated my life to serving and combating this issue.
Yeah, and so this is the big dichotomy. The left will tell you, Jack, you can't talk about fatherlessness because, you know, you played in the NFL and you have money and you're a person of privilege. And what you need to do is be quiet and let the people who know about it talk about it. And I come against that. It's a lie from the pit of hell. You can speak the truth. No matter what part of the culture you're coming from or what your success level is, the truth is the truth is the truth. And the other part about the conversation here is that you mentioned the Jezebel spirit and this matriarchal bent that our culture has now assumed. Well, what ends up happening with that is you have people who truly believe in the kind of women's empowerment movement, which has brought us to the brink of destruction. It is why we are where we are right now. The empowerment of women who don't believe in tradition. They don't believe in the word of God. They don't believe in submission or any of the other things that kind of the trad wife hashtag that is gaining popularity because it's true. It's the truth. These are the things that we need in our lives today. And if we deny the truth, it doesn't change the truth. It just makes us fools.
Exactly. I mean, you know, you got to have a fear of God. You know, that's the beginning of wisdom, as the word teaches us. And so, you know, what you just described is folks that live without that fear of God, right? There's got to be some level of thought about the afterlife and wanting to serve Christ and finding full salvation and full surrender. So the Jezebel spirit brings on ego. The Jezebel spirit brings about, you know, covetousness and idolatry and thinking about, you know, self and pleasing the body. You know, but what the word tells us is that we must die. We must die in the flesh and be reborn in the spirit. And so I think if we don't have that perspective, it's really hard to grasp, you know, some of the words that we're talking about tonight, Stacy, because it's hard to really see it. You have the scales on your eyes. And so, you know, you want to find, you know, all these carnal ways of thinking to be able to justify the sins of this world. And it comes back to just that. It comes back to sin. And fatherlessness is a sin. You know, and there are situations, you know, like, you know, if you lose your father and father dies and certain things happen. But having kids out of wedlock is a sin. You know, I've been a sinner for many, many years. And so that had to be redeemed through the blood of Jesus. And so for us to try to normalize sinful behavior and think that we're not going to leave a mark on the world is a lie in itself. You know, and that's why the last verse in the Bible, in the Old Testament, said he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to the fathers. And lest he will come and smite the world with a curse. And we are living that curse right now all over the earth. And unfortunately, we're the epicenter right here in the United States of America, the most fatherless nation on the planet, where the majority of kids of color were born without a father in the home, and where the majority of kids of color are going to school for a reason my math proficiency levels are in the tank. You know, the majority of the kids of color who live in urban and inner city areas are highly likely to end up in prison or jail for being involved in the criminal justice system. And so it's a sad reality. It's a sad truth. The fact that people want to deny the real root cause is really revealing. And, you know, not to make it political, but you can look at both sides. You can look at both arguments. You see one side that wants to bring up a bunch of excuses. And you have another side that's really willing to talk about these issues and at least attempt at solutions. And so that's what I'm about. That's what the Jack Brewer Foundation is here for. We have, you know, a staff of 30 that go out each and every day fighting this battle. We have fatherhood outreach centers all across the state of Florida. We're opening up our new national fatherhood center in Washington, D.C. And so we're excited to continue to take this this issue on head on and push for legislation to support programs like ours that go into the prisons to work with the fathers, that go into the communities that help empower the fatherless. And don't back down to this leftist approach and wokeness that's being put onto our children. And so we're trying to hold those accountable who need to be held accountable, and we'll continue to work towards this mission for me until the day I die.
And so under that same thought, please share with us how, if someone's listening tonight and thinking, you know, I want to support, I want to be part of the mission, because you talked about being in the prisons, you talked about the work that you do with children. I've seen you online in these spaces, mentoring these children, bringing them up, giving them the thought process that they should be prayed over, that they're loved, that they're of value, changing their whole mindset so that they can begin to worship God on their own and have a relationship with Him and change their trajectory. How can people support your work?
I encourage you, one, come see us. Come see us in South Florida at our headquarters. We welcome, you know, many volunteers and a lot of our donors to see our work inside the prisons, in the community, even our community outreach projects that we do. We welcome you to come see it for yourself. Also check us out online. Follow us at the JackBrewerFoundation.org, or you can, you know, follow me at JackBrewerBSI. And we just encourage you all. I mean, if you're looking for an organization that's getting their hands dirty, whose top executives don't get paid, that would be myself. But I do this as my ministry. I pour into it with every ounce that I have in me. And so I just, you know, I encourage anyone who wants to fight this battle. You know, politicians can do a lot, but we the people can do even more.
We can do more, and with the right attitude, if we have the right beliefs, in other words, we're doing it for the right reason, if we truly believe that God's word is true and that it won't return void, then we can actually make huge strides with these young people, because they're desperate for the truth, they're desperate to be loved and respected, and they're desperate to understand how they can have a part of the American dream and how they can live well and be successful. These children know that there is a way to be successful, but they feel like nobody cares enough about them to tell them or to teach them the way. And that's not true, because with people like yourself out there, I saw the work you were doing during the pandemic and during the tornadoes that came through, and even during the hurricanes, you guys were out there in these very poverty-stricken areas helping people, bringing them food and supplies. It was unbelievable to watch online. So if you're supporting the Brewer Foundation, you are supporting that work. So don't hesitate. If you feel led, get out there, get onto his website and offer up some assistance. Any last words you have for us tonight? I can't wait to read your article over at Fox News on MLK Day.
No, I just say let's remember Dr. King's legacy, and let's, you know, as we are a nation of people that need to have each other's support, let's not depend on government for everything. Let's lock arms as one nation under God. And fight for some of these issues, particularly our civil rights issue of today, which is fatherlessness. Thank you so much for having me today.
You're welcome. It's good to talk to you. Look forward to seeing you in 2024. It's the JackBrewerFoundation.org, thejackbrewerfoundation.org. Everyone, please consider offering your support. They could really use it. They're doing such amazing work, and people are being helped. Jack, have a wonderful evening. Happy weekend to you. And we will be back with more Stacy on the Right after this.